Good evening. This is Mimi Poser at the Guggenheim. This week, we're continuing our discussions with people who are involved in our summer arts festival of dance, film, and music. Tonight's guests are Annette Michelson and Jonas Mekas. Ms. Michelson is a film critic, a teacher, and the organizer of the film segment of the festival. Mr. Mekas is a film critic for the Village Voice and the director of one of the films in the series, Reminiscences of a Journey to Lithuania. Ms. Michelson, you say that this series, called New Forms in Film, was conceived to show major large-scale works not often publicly shown, and to present recent tendencies in advanced filmmaking. What are these tendencies?
Well, they're somewhat varied. The series is conceived to show recent tendencies, but also to indicate that developments in these recent tendencies, strictly contemporary ones, represent a new point of maturity in the development of independent filmmaking in America. Among these tendencies, those of particular importance, I'd cite, to begin with, the development in the diaristic and essayistic film, represented by the first film in the series, the one which we've chosen to head off the series, by Jonas Mekas, and which represents a kind of extension of the personal diary film, of which he is an acknowledged master, and also a kind of sophistication of the essayistic approach to experience in film form. Another tendency, I think, is involved in the reconsideration within film of the film medium itself, of its means and its tools and its implements and its techniques, so that in a film like Tom Tom the Piper's Son, Jacobs, in Landau's films, in the films of Hollis Frampton, we have a kind of investigation within the filmic form of the ways in which films are made and in the ways in which filmic illusion is sustained. Another tendency I want to point to, I think, is the reinvestigation of narrative, what it means and how one can, with some kind of innovative freshness in 1970-72, propose narrative again in film. And Yvonne Rainer's film, Lives of Performance, of Performers, is an exploration in that direction. Those are some of the tendencies.
How do you feel that these films differ specifically from the films of the 50s and 60s?
They differ, first of all, I think, in their variety. That is, they represent, in relation to the 50s, a much greater diversity of modes. There is perhaps a less of a monolithic emphasis on the autobiographical experience. There's an extraordinary range of varieties in editing technique and in actual shooting techniques. They tend very often to be less dependent upon very, very assertive editing, and they tend to reinstate within the film a kind of legibility, which was not the hallmark of the advanced filmmaking of the 50s.
Would you say that there's any difference in these, the one being with the emphasis on the director rather on the technicalities of the film? Do you feel that there, some of the films of the 50s and 60s were very dependent on new techniques?
No, I think they're really more dependent than these films are. I really do conceive of techniques as being integral to filmmaking. It is not that. I think that there is a difference in style. They are, for example, much less indebted to the kinds of styles proposed pictorially and even sculpturally by surrealism and abstract expressionism, two movements which had a great effect upon independent filmmaking in the 50s. The films that we are going to see this summer at the Guggenheim detached themselves somewhat from those styles.
And now let's talk about one of those films. Mr. Mekas, would you tell us something about your film?
Reminiscences of a Journey to Lithuania. I shot it last July in Lithuania, of course, my home, my hometown, I went there for the first time in 25 years. And it differs a little bit from my other diaries, notes and sketches in style and, of course, in content. It consists of three parts. One is my early years in Brooklyn when I came to the United States in 1950 as a displaced person. And the second part is in Lithuania, and the third part is in Austria, in Vienna. Now they all tie in together, one has to see it. It is, of course, in a form of notes, brief notes, what I saw, how I felt, my reactions with the camera to the immediate situation there, using, of course, sort of newer techniques, that is maybe more impressionistic and more spontaneous, and doing most of the structuring, editing during the shooting, and practically all of the footage that I shot, I'm eliminated very little.
Did you yourself do the camera work?
Yes, of course. Because it's my kind of shooting, in this type of shooting, I am the only one who reacts to this situation. Here I am, for the first time, back there, home, and very, very helpless, because when you go home for the, 25 years, you are so overwhelmed by memories that you are not, you don't have much control of yourself. In a sense you are hopeless, and helpless. So that, I am the one who is really reacting to the situation there. And I am the only one who can capture it then with a camera, because the camera has to react, in its movements, in its, pacings. It has to be my extension of my eyes, my body, that moment. Nobody else can be in my place. Nobody else can shoot.
Yes. You wrote it
for me.
Didn't you?
No, I wrote it with my camera.
Yes.
Camera is my typewriter, my pen. I reacted. The camera is a tool with which I react to the situation. And I was writing at that moment when I was reacting it. That is one aspect of the new cinema, that is doing all the structuring during the shooting, all the editing during the shooting.
In other words, you aren't following a preconceived notion.
No, how could I, if this was my first time in 25
yes.
years, that I don't know anything. I had, of course, imagining, I tried to imagine how the situation, the people, and my mother, brothers will look, or, but of course, it was only imaginings which had very little to do with actual reality. So that's why you cannot write a script, you cannot write any notes. The script, the big note is the situation there by itself that in which you find yourself when you go to a to the place of your early memories, which of course then blocks much of your memory. My memories blocked much of the reality as it is now, so that I could most of the time realize so maybe what I remembered, that is my past, more than the actual reality now.
I think that Jonas's point isn't to, by the way, is covered in something that occurred to me while you were introducing us. Because you introduced him as the director of his film, and that presupposes that he is directing other people who are making the film, that he is a mediator.
Yes,
and
ma'am.
Indeed, in Hollywood and elsewhere,
yes.
The director exists. That is where I think we tend to talk of artists like Jonas Mekas as filmmakers. They
yes.
make the film rather than...
Would you compare this to one of the other diaries in the series? Was this done in a similar manner?
Yes, I think so. For example, there is a strong diaristic component in Joyce Whedon's film, Reason Over Passion. It's not as explicitly diaristic as...
When you say diary, you really mean diary.
Yes, but it involves a... it is essentially a gathering together of material involving personal impressions and reactions to her reconfrontation with her own native land, which is that of Canada. She's a young Canadian artist who has been living and working in New York for many years and who has recently been caught up again in a sense of her own homeland through her involvement with nationalist tendencies in Canada. And I think that the two films play interestingly against each other.
I'm going to change the subject a bit. Both of you have or are still functioning in dual or plural roles. Ms. Michelson, you were an art editor and are now a film critic. How did this happen?
Well, it's very long and very complex, but I think that I've simply been used to looking at things all my life and to thinking about them. I think, had the good luck for about 12 or 14 years of my life to live in a culture in which filmmaking was not, as in the United States at that time, separated geographically from the cultural center of the country, which is to say I spent most of my adult life in France. And so I was introduced, in a sense, to film at the same time, but and in the same ways, as I gained a certain consciousness about painting, literature, music, dance, and so on. That, I think, was a great advantage. And also, I became aware about 1960-62 that with the rise of color painting, color field painting in America, beginning to think about the work of Noland and Politsky at that time, Morris Lewis, and beginning to think about the critical task, I became aware that there was something happening in American painting which it seemed to me was going to exhaust itself sooner or later, and that implicit in the aspirations of color field painting was a hidden subtext, the rise of film. And it seemed to me that it might be interesting.
In other words, you feel that film is going to supersede or has superseded. I had another question to ask you about whether you felt the two forms were coming closer together, possibly overlapping each other.
Well, it's, again, a very complex matter. My feeling is not that film is going to supersede painting. My feeling is that painting has sustained itself magnificently in our culture for some time. It is having, I think, a great deal of difficulty doing so at the moment, and that the energies going into filmmaking are perhaps more charged, more abundant from those which are going into painting. It seems to me also that what began to happen was that there was increasing implicit awareness of that on the part of artists who turned from painting and sculpture to pieces involving a temporal dimension, to happenings, to dance, to even certain forms of minimal sculpture. I was, for myself, very, very much involved with the advent and development of minimal sculpture, particularly with the work of Robert Morris, who, in a sense, synthesized all these activities. And it seemed to me that that temporality, which was attracting artists, would eventuate in a concern with film. And I think, indeed, it is doing so. At the same time, I became aware of the fact that perhaps the most successful and the most interesting developments of this nature were being accomplished by people who had set out to be painters and photographers and sculptors, who continued to do so, but who went almost directly into film. So I think it is undeniable that the work of Michael Snow, of Paul Sharitz, of Hollis Frampton, of George Landau, all these people who were painters and sculptors, but who in a sense sensed the temporal direction which their work must take quite early, is the best work being done in film. Now we see, retrospectively, or somewhat later, that some very, very important artists who have made their careers almost wholly in sculpture and painting, people like Keith Sonnier, like Richard Serra, are turning to filmmaking. But they are turning to filmmaking, I think, as an adjunct, and as a somewhat parallel field of activity to their major preoccupations. And I think they've been largely outdistanced by the filmmakers.
Mr. Mekas, you played your role You are a critic and a filmmaker. Would you talk about that? Which were you first?
First, I do not know what. I think they both came at the same time because I like dialogue, I like discussion, I like I cannot separate the two or really three or four. But in a sense, I'm not exactly what is known traditionally in other arts and other areas as a critic. I ended up since I came or got interested in the filmmaking during the most active, exciting sort of period, last 15 years of the American cinema. I found myself maybe more in the place of a minister of propaganda than that of a critic, that is, you know, to introduce certain films or to bring them to the attention of the people without really going into extensive and complex and difficult work of a critic, but maybe more that of one who propagandizes and brings to the attention. That is more or less my function in that area.
This brings up the almost obvious.
As a diarist, you see, in a sense, I was doing the same. I was the diarist in that area also. That, like, I kept notes of what has been going and bringing to the attention also day by day, week by week. That is.
Could we have a general question? What do you think the role of a critic should be?
Well, my feeling is that there are different roles. There's no one role for a critic, and it varies at different times. My feeling, by the way, is, too, that Jonas has been a critic and has served an extremely important critical function. I recently read through 10 years of his criticism in The Village Voice, which has been collected and published in book form by McMillan. And I was struck by one thing, and that is that apart from the diaristic aspect of his work, and apart from the fact that he indeed does function as a minister of propaganda, that I haven't ever read any other book of film criticism which gives me a sense of the whole period and what was happening in other media as well as in film. Because when one reads through his work, one also learns a great deal about what was happening in the plastic arts, what was happening in dance and happenings, and the development of the sensibility of the 60s. For my own feeling about what I want to do is somewhat different. I began as a newspaper journalist, and so I'm relieved in a way at not having to meet those weekly deadlines. And I have been very interested in, first of all, establishing in some detail and in some analytic detail the nature of filmmaking enterprise, the relationship of film to other arts, and analyzing the ways in which filmic consciousness is a particularly radical form of consciousness in our era. That is really my concern.
Probably the way that we have a body of filmmaking during, you know, within certain decade that we have now, then we have also a body of criticism, and we have a great variety among the filmmakers. No one filmmaker represents, you know, really, if you would see the work on the one filmmaker, you would have only a very narrow idea of what the whole field is all about, you know, what are the tendencies, the directions, the styles, and the aspects. You have to see maybe 15 or 20 filmmakers. The same, the body of the criticism is represented also by 4, 5, 6 different personalities, names, and each one covers different aspects.
You seem to see criticism from a historical point of view.
That's a functional, how it develops and is connected, and I think that different writers then perform different function during the period. I see like myself doing one thing during the same period. Of course, you know, the other aspect was my work as the editor of Film Culture magazine. There, you know, the work was different. But then Pierre and Sidney is someone else again, and Annette is again someone else. I see, like, and only together we cover the field, and of course there is no limit.
Do you see much difference in the activity between this country and European countries?
Enormous difference.
What?
I think
there is very little happening in other countries at this moment, in this area. Very, very little. There was something happening, beginning to happen in Italy 3 years ago, in Germany, but never got off the ground. There are certain personalities, individual filmmakers, but never grew into
a
movement.
Right after the war, Italy just seemed to emerge, burgeon, with many filmmakers and
films.
Yeah.
Excuse me. Mm-hmm. We discussed there, you see, then the neo-realist style in cinema, and there, of course, the Italian contribution is immense.
Well, would you say that the United States is that country today?
I think so. I think one of the difficulties is that in Europe, in France as well as in Italy, and in other countries, but in those two particular countries, which were indeed in the avant-garde of filmmaking after the war, entrance for young filmmakers into the commercial system of filmmaking was very much easier than for Americans. The Americans really had to develop on their own independently and have done so after many, many years of struggle. As we all know, the commercial structure of filmmaking on a large scale is breaking down, both in Hollywood in this country as well as in Chilecittà and in Paris, so that nothing, in a sense, has replaced that structure into which European filmmakers are used to fitting. And they have not yet developed the kinds of energies and the kinds of strategies with which to operate as independently and as innovatively as Americans are now doing. I would say that American independent filmmaking now undoubtedly occupies a status very similar to that of American painting in, say, the 50s and 60s, when it was really beginning not simply to develop, but to manifest itself as not only of importance, but, let's say, primary in the understanding of art in the world today.
We have just a couple of minutes left, and I see that there are several films done by women. I was wondering if you'd like to say something about that, Ms. Michelson.
Yes, I would, of course. There's a long film already referred to, Reason of the Passion by Joyce Whelan, and Lies of Performance by Yvonne Rainer. The contribution of women to filmmaking is something with which, as a woman, I'm naturally concerned. And I wanted to present two works by women, but they are two works by outstanding women artists who already have a good deal of reputation and status here. One of them, Yvonne Rainer, is a dancer, and it is, by the way, in the grand tradition of American independent filmmakers that dancers turn to filmmaking and make very good films. She's been preceded by both Maya Darren and Shirley Clarke, both of whom were dancers originally. I consider these two works really important, and I'm just very pleased to be able to present them in this series.
It would seem to me that women don't have the same difficulties in this independent filmmaking as they do in commercial filmmaking.
They don't have the same difficulties. They simply have the same difficulties that all male filmmakers have. It's a heroic kind of enterprise.
But that's okay. Before we leave, I'd like to tell our audience that the film program will continue until August 13th and that tickets are available at the Guggenheim Museum admissions desk. Thank you, Mr. Mekas, Ms. Michelson, and good night to our audience. Thank you.